Wanted to talk a little bit about Martin Luther King. You really can't say enough about him.
No.
I was watching, now forgive me,
This meeting is.
I don't usually say things that are politically correct, so I'm sure it's gonna just not gonna come out good. And I don't mean anything by it. I don't but I was watching The View the other day with my wife, and they were talking about Martin Luther King. And they brought on this brother, and he was, let's see, he was on that new movie, that new Color Purple. And then he also played Bayard Rustin. And they were making the whole thing about that. They were supposed to be talking about Martin Luther King, and they were talking about Bayard Rustin. And the reason why they were talking about him is because he was gay. And okay, yeah, there were people in the movement. There were all kind of people there. James Baldwin, and others. But I felt like they put too much emphasis on it. I that's what I perceive. And I saw this thing. Do you guys ever watch this brother? His name is well, his show's called Professor of Truth. You ever see him? Okay, that's good. So I'm going to lead. Mama Rose came in and gave Mama Zarita a very great compliment, and leading an oratorical contest, and I want to lead with that this evening. Thank you all for coming, and we're going to just talk about Martin Luther King. And can everyone see that?
Yes.
Okay, here we go.
Kind of nervous.
Good afternoon.
But I just took a
Can you increase the volume?
Let's see, where is it? Where's my, oh, okay, yeah. Oh, I had it way down, sorry. Start again. All right, here we go.
I was kind of nervous.
Good afternoon.
But I just took a deep breath and did my poem.
There's chairs up there, chairs up here. It's gonna be a lot
and
of people,
and that's a big stage.
Everybody really wants us to win.
Good afternoon. My name is Gregory Payton.
Thank you for this opportunity to be here.
Today, I will be performing a speech that I wrote on my own.
The Martin Luther King Oratorical Fest is a deep tradition that the entire community looks forward to.
That's Skyline High School.
My black is beautiful.
They're allowed to be who they are, to get up there, no matter how scared they are.
They're profound, and they have a vision.
And then when they make it, it's just nothing like it.
Today, we are ready. Beautiful girls full of potential.
The Lord is my shepherd.
The time is always right to do the right thing.
We fight today, we fight tomorrow, but that doesn't stop our sorrow.
It's time to stand up against hate.
Was that what you were talking about, Mama Rose? Is that the one? No?
No.
Yeah. Mama Rose?
No, it's not the one. The
yes,
one I
was,
the one I was talking
about. All not being in the land.
Was strictly the
oh,
one.
Oh, God.
So it's not the same. The one I was talking about showed me the whole program when she worked with the young fellow who won that year.
Okay.
So if I ever find it, I'll let you know.
Okay. Okay.
That trailer just picked barely 2 minutes out of a full movie. Yes. So
yes.
It may have missed the part that you remember.
Yeah, that's the trailer. And so We Are the Dream, kids of the MLK Oratorical Fest. And so you just saw a piece of it.
You know, I saw those red chairs. That's Skyline High School. That's where I went to high school.
Yes, finals is held at Skyline.
Wow. All right. Well, I'm going to go back to YouTube. Did you guys see that? Okay. I mean, was there any pauses or glitches? And it was good. Ed? Okay. Thanks. So this is about. Let's see. How long is it? It's 13 minutes. So let's look at it, and then talk about it on the other side. I think it's very good information. I like listening to this guy. And he goes by Professor of Truth. And I guess I should share screen first. How about that? Hey, Sarasvati. Who are you? Okay.
Family and fellow soldiers, I'm the professor, and this is the Moment of Truth.
At the very same time that America refused to give the Negro any land, through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that it was willing to undergird its white peasants from Europe with an economic floor. But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm. Not only that, they provided county agents to further their expertise in farming. Not only that, they provided low interest rates in order that they could mechanize their farms. Not only that, today many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies not to farm, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. Now, this is what we are faced with, and this is a reality. Now, when we come to Washington in this campaign, we are coming to get our check.
America freed the slaves in 1863 through the Emancipation Proclamation of Abraham Lincoln, but gave the slaves no land or nothing in reality, and as a matter of fact, to get started on. At the same time, America was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that there was a willingness to give the white peasants from Europe an economic base. And yet it refused to give its black peasants from Africa, who came here involuntarily in chains and had worked free for 244 years, any kind of economic base. And so emancipation for the Negro was really freedom to hunger. It was freedom to the winds and rains of heaven. It was freedom without food to eat or land to cultivate, and therefore it was freedom and famine at the same time. And when white Americans tell the Negro to lift himself by his own bootstraps, they don't look over the legacy of slavery and segregation. I believe we ought to do all we can and seek to lift ourselves by our own bootstraps, but it's a cruel jest to say to a bootless man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. And many Negroes, by the thousands and millions, have been left bootless as a result of all of these years of oppression and as a result of a society that deliberately made his color a stigma and something worthless and degrading.
This is the Black Grassroots Remembrance of Dr. King. But in order to remember something, you need to know the accurate version of what happened. For a people who are truly empowered, they don't get their knowledge of themselves or their heroes from their oppressors. We have to be honest with the fact that there has been a false version of Dr. King that has been enforced upon the world by the white media, and it was done specifically to distance you, or rather to get you to distance yourself, from the real Dr. King. Dr. King was the subject of countless smear campaigns. Most of the lies and harassment that Dr. King and his family endured originated with J. Edgar Hoover's FBI, sending phony letters to his home, making harassing phone calls, and white power used some turncoat Negroes to push these lies too. Now, there were a lot of lies that the white supremacists could have used to try to discredit Dr. King, to undermine him, but they used the lie about infidelity for two reasons. First, they knew the power of the civil rights leaders like Dr. King was based on the public understanding that these men were morally right. The public's clear understanding that the black community is the voice of morality was what gave the movement its irresistible force. So the FBI, along with other bad actors, pushed the lie about King and adultery because they wanted to undermine the moral legitimacy of the movement. And saying a lie that big, that Dr. King was having affairs, and worse, having affairs with white women, that was seen as the perfect way to do that. After all, there were a bunch of good white liberals who actually were just looking for the first chance they could to ditch the movement, having gotten their photo op. Charlton Heston comes to mind. But the second reason that the character assassination of Dr. King as an adulterer was so attractive to the FBI was that they also hoped these lies would pressure Coretta Scott King into divorcing Martin. If they could have made that happen, that would have been a huge victory for the enemy, to turn Dr. King's own wife against him and to do it with lies. Only it didn't work. They spread the lies far and wide, spread them to people in the movement, people who Dr. King had known. But Dr. King's reputation was so ironclad for the people who actually knew him that the lies simply couldn't take hold. They couldn't get people to abandon him. The lies about morality were simply not being believed. It's been over 50 years since Dr. King's assassination. J. Edgar Hoover was still alive at the time that he was killed, and for several years afterwards. Now, common sense would tell you that if J. Edgar Hoover was still the FBI director after King was assassinated, and if he had any dirt on Dr. King, wouldn't he have made it public a long time ago? Yet no such evidence has ever been revealed, because it doesn't exist. You have plenty of phony articles and people claiming this or that, but nobody in 50-plus years has ever presented any proof. The lies about King having affairs was an FBI COINTELPRO campaign, pure disinformation, an urban legend promoted by anti-black racists. The lies were that there were audio, video, recording, surveillance films. For 50-plus years, these rumors and claims have been circulating, and to this day, not one shred of any of these forms of proof has ever come to light. It seems at least once a year, some online publication or other will claim that an alleged confidant or somebody who allegedly knew Dr. King or allegedly met him or was in the back of the march that he conducted, somebody will claim that they saw him in a hotel with some woman who wasn't his wife. That's one of the lies the white media and its boosters in the society told about him. Another was that Dr. King didn't believe in radical changes to the society to balance the wealth gap. If you actually read what Dr. King wrote, if you actually listen to his speeches like the Three Evils speech, you find out that's not true at all. The Dr. King presented to you by the white media isn't the real one. What the white media did was to manufacture a toothless, sanitized, phony version of King in their image. One meant to get us to stop fighting white supremacy and instead hope that we can just wish the savages into civilized behavior. In other words, a version of Dr. King that would tell us lies about letting the status quo stand, in the hopes that if it stands long enough, maybe it will change. Nothing changes unless you make it to change. Dr. King understood that. That's what he was doing. You see, the enemy doesn't want you to know the real Dr. King. All they want to tell you is that he had some kind of dream, and even then they can't tell you the entire speech.
But I must confess that that dream that I had that day has at many points turned into a nightmare. Now, I'm not one to lose hope. I keep on hoping. I still have faith in the future. But I've had to analyze many things over the last few years, and I would say over the last few months. I've gone through a lot of soul-searching and agonizing moments, and I've come to see that we have many more difficult days ahead, and some of the old optimism was a little superficial, and now it must be tempered with a solid realism.
The real Dr. King may not have been strident or hyper-aggressive with his rhetoric, but he was utterly uncompromising. When it came time to call out the hypocrisy from the dominant society, he did so without blinking. And he didn't care who didn't like it, though he did care a great deal that his people know it. But you won't know any of that if all you heard about is the white media telling you about the dream and that's it. Go and discover Dr. King for yourself. You'll walk away with a totally different impression of him. Take out some time to acquaint yourself with the real Dr. King. When you do, you'll find that the image of Dr. King as an intentionally unoffensive man wasn't true at all. When the enemy realized that they couldn't defeat Dr. King outright, they certainly couldn't overcome his message and couldn't drive wedges between him and his wife or him and those who followed him. Instead, they killed him, and then spent their time trying to co-opt his message, to twist it, distort it, pervert it, water it down, to take everything that he stood for and miseducate the public by presenting a fraudulent version of the man, one who was no threat to white power. This was done in order to alienate the younger generations of black people from what Dr. King was and what he truly stood for, to put forward the idea that while young black people were in the streets fighting for change, well, Dr. King, all he stood for was not hurting white people's feelings. But the truth always gets the last word, because what they did to Dr. King is what they're now trying to do with reparations. They tried to drive a wedge between Dr. King and his wife, but that failed. So after his death, they tried to drive a wedge between Dr. King and the black community, to say that he was colorblind and nothing else. He only thought about kids playing together. This was done to make a lot of us think that that was all there was to him, that he was some sort of naive dreamer and best left forgotten, that he wasn't relevant. And a lot of black people went for that. That is, until some other folks started actually reading up on the man and reminding people what he truly stood for, going beyond the commercials. But you'll notice the one thing that Dr. King didn't say when he was talking about coming to get our check. He talked about what we're owed, about what we're coming for, and how it's ours. He said a lot of things. But the one thing Dr. King didn't say was that we were asking for our check. Because he wasn't asking, and neither should we. The enemy is still running the same old plays, still repeating the same old lies about him. We have to be ready with some plays that they haven't seen. The reason that we remember our heroes like Dr. King is so that we can draw strength from them. Their struggles should not discourage you. They should inspire you, remind you that you're part of a continuum of the longest, most important fight for freedom in human history, right here in the U.S. What Dr. King wanted for his people was that we come to know who we are for ourselves, and armed with this knowledge, we would fight to be able to live our lives and make the most of it. His dream was that the empowerment of his people would become reality. When you bring up the real Dr. King, you'll find the phony liberals and the self-proclaimed colorblind conservatives get real uncomfortable. The version of Dr. King that they invented was supposed to be a validation of the dominant society. But when you tell them what Dr. King was really about, when you remind them what he really stood for, they get their feelings hurt, because they find out what Dr. King really thought about them. And his true feelings don't lend themselves to a I have a dream cardboard cutout that the white media manufactured. The reason that they hate Dr. King is because he showed what a real hero is. He was somebody who they could never match up to. None of their own little white supremacist icons measured up. They looked at him and he reminded them exactly how small, how puny, how insignificant they are. That while they had to invent lies about how their heroes were moral, Dr. King did it for real. And that just ate them alive. They looked at him and saw everything that they were not and could never be. This is why states like Florida want to ban books about Dr. King. Because the people who he fought for were talking about the real Dr. King, and the racists don't want that to go any further. Except they can't stop us. Honoring Dr. King is about reclamation. Reclamation of our past, reclamation of knowledge of ourselves, reclamation of our power to define who we are on our own terms. Seeing one of our icons the way he truly is, it's about self-determination. We decide who we honor and who we don't, and we do it based on whether that person honored us and empowered us specifically. We honor Dr. King the way that he wanted us to, not begging for permission from the white government or hoping that they will acknowledge it so we can have a day off. We don't ask for a day, we take a day. Today is Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday, which coincidentally also falls on the same day as the federal holiday. But we don't care about the federal holiday. We owe it to ourselves to become acquainted with the real Dr. King, and do not care how that makes anyone else feel. Why? Because that's what our Dr. King, the real Dr. King, spent his life doing. And it was a life well lived. Good day, and be one.
Ashe.
So that was that brother's known as the Professor of Truth, and I listened to him. I subscribe to him. He's really good. Hey, Minister Amadi, Minister Amadi's there.
Sugar. Hey, good to be here with everybody.
Sister Asata, Barbara Giles, and somebody, iPhone. Maybe that's Minister Malley, I'm not sure. But glad everyone is here. So let's talk about Dr. King. I was 10 years old when Dr. King was assassinated. And that was very, I mean, that year, 68 and 69 were very, you know, historic years. You know, and then later that summer, Robert Kennedy was assassinated. Anyway, what are your opinion? What, first of all, what did you think of that that brother?
That was a very well done. I had never heard him talk about farmers and land, that particular speech. Never heard that particular speech.
Isn't that something? Yeah. That's not the Martin Luther King that we usually hear about, you know? We don't usually hear about him. I mean, really, if just that speech alone, he would talk about it, you know, that would be very poignant and impressive. Yeah. Go ahead, Saraswati, send that to me. I saw you put that on there. Go ahead,
Bill. I'll tell you what, they'll do anything to break up anybody. For them to be so low down dirty to say that he had affairs and all that stuff. I mean, yeah. I tell you. And also, Dr. Martin Luther King has something to do with Africa. He was connected with Africa as well, from my understanding.
Well, Dr. King went to Ghana to witness Kwame Nkrumah's inauguration. So, he did have something to do with Africa. Great comment, Sugar D. Go ahead, Bill.
He didn't go as far as I've sort of said. What we'll say before that, in fact, that land is the basis of independence. And again, Dr. King did sort of hint at that idea that, in fact, by denying Africans land, that denied our ancestors the chance to be independent as all those other folk were. The handout, the Homestead Acts that handed out 160 acres to white applicants, basically encouraged them to go out to Minnesota, to Colorado, to wherever they wanted, and set up government in any shape that served them. That is something we have never had. There's a question about whether that will ever happen. But that seems to be the fundamental thing and the reason why we are constantly undermined, because we are kept dependent. We are not allowed to structure things to serve ourselves.
Ashe, Zarita, did you have your hand up? Did you want to say something?
Yes. What really stood out for me was, as he was speaking, I've never seen the images that we see on TV of him speaking, and how his face looks, how his eyes look, how he's making contact with the audience. He said, "We're going to get our check." And the look on his face, again, his prose is always, when he speaks, is always outstanding. Yeah. Truly the jolly. What stood out for me today was the look of his eyes, his face, and the gaze that he gave his audience.
All right. Anyone else have an observation? Thank you. That's a very good observation. Anyone else?
Well, I would like to just make a brief comment. Uh-huh. And I really appreciated the video and the discussion about the real MLK Jr. But in some conversations, you know, in our community, you know, people were saying, if they gave us land, whose land was it? Was it theirs, or was it the people who were native to that land? Mm-hmm. And so for us to feel that we should get some land that really belonged to somebody else other than the Europeans. And if the land from the Europeans was taken back, it would be given to the native people who owned it. So we become kind of intermediaries between that real issue, you know, of stealing and dominance. And, you know, I appreciated, you know, MLK's discussion about the land. But I think, you know, today even, there's lots of talk, you know, about the land not belonging to us or them, but to the native people. And if we have some, if we have some coming together with the people who are native to the land, then they can share that land with us. And there are some places, I think, even today, you know, where they allow, you know, a certain period of time for people to be on the land, but the land really belongs to them. So I just wanted to put that in there, you know, but I just really appreciate everything MLK did.
Oh, good point. Good point. Zarita, you have your hand up. Go ahead.
Yes. I want to echo what Mama said, but I also want to echo something you said when you gave your message this past Sunday. You said we have a lot of reclaiming to do. And part of that reclaiming is our presence in this part of the world. And from what I've been studying, we were here before the slave ship.
Mm-hmm.
Came to this part of the world on ships that we built with our hands.
Mm-hmm.
And that we are part of the people who are very, I don't know if the word is indigenous, because I still think of Africa, but thousands of years, our people were here. Asar, Ivan Van Sertima talks of that. David Imhotep in his book talks of that. And so there's a lot of reclaiming that we have to do because we were present.
I'm sorry, Baba, but you know, I don't know how to raise my hand. And the other part of that, the Indian people got land. They have land right now. They have money right now. We still don't. We still don't. So saying that the land belonged to them, it's part of it, but they have land. They have these casinos. They're getting their reparations. We still haven't.
Good point. Good point. Let's get back on Dr. King. There's some things that I didn't know. I found this out about 20 years ago. But do you know that Martin Luther King wasn't his original name? Did anybody know that?
No, I didn't.
Yes.
Anybody want to address that? Anybody that knows want to touch that subject?
Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. Sr. named him Michael.
Yes, they were both named Michael. Yeah.
And he later decided to change his name from Michael to Martin Luther King, to Martin Luther.
Yes. And that happened when he was 10. That's a very interesting fact. Someone, it says iPhone, they've raised their hand. Who is that?
Minister Imhotep, it's Judy from Atlanta.
Oh, Judy. Okay, all right.
I raised my hand. I'm in a store, but I was having trouble saying something. I just wanted to add to the couple of quick comments that were made about us being indigenous to America. And I was thinking that's one of the one of the many reasons why they don't want us to study history. Mm-hmm. And they don't want it talked about in the textbooks, because with the reparations
all of the reparation bills and everything that are going around, they know that eventually when we start studying that history publicly and presenting the facts, that they're going to definitely have to give us the land, and we might have to send them back off of our land.
Yeah, and there have really been some good studies, you know, about the fact that we were here and we shared land with the people who we call native to this land. That, you know, our migration out of the motherland, you know, went up and over and down, you know, into what we call, you know, the United States and other parts of you know, America, South America, you know. We were the originals, literally everywhere. And so if it goes beyond what we call native, we are native. And that could be something that is really put on the table as well.
That, just to add to that, also, Minister Imhotep, this is a question. Isn't there, I thought I've seen some maps, some trading maps that where Africans were trading in the Americas way back. You know, I've seen those maps, so they surely need to close the, like they did in the skit with Richard Pryor when he went into the cave and found out everybody was black and they closed the door. That's what they're doing with history. They don't want us to open those books too deep because they know the scholars are going to pop out. Everybody's going to realize who we really are, and we are the indigenous people of this land.
Good comments, Sister Judy. So I saw, let's see, before you had your hand up, Sugar D, somebody else had their hand up. And
Brother Ali. Brother Ali.
Ali, did you want to say something?
Yes, I just wanted to say that there's a lot of African-American people now that are saying that they are Indians. And also the comment that I wanted to mention was I heard the Nation of Islam said that they did a calculation of the reparations owed, and they said that they would owe us the whole country. So I just wanted to say that.
Interesting point. Sugar D, go ahead, and then Sister Judy.
Just so happened, we're bringing it up about land. I was hunting for this book. Somebody just handed me this book recently, and it says Black people are indigenous to the Americas. And in here, it's for research material for the inquisitive. And it talks about the different areas. Say, for instance, Virginia. Virginia was not only, it was encompassed Washington, D.C., Tennessee, Kentucky. I mean, when Virginia first came out, and this is of people that were saying, like your Christopher Columbus's people, and Gosnell, where the queen sent them out, you know, they were explorers, and they talk about all of the people that they met had black faces, and they were dark people. They were not like the quote unquote native Indian. And in this book, it talks about Georgia. It talks about everywhere. Cape Natick, Maine even talks about the guy sent back and said that the people's face were black. So this right here says we were here first, and this is our land. When they even Christopher Columbus wrote back and talked about the black skins and the black faces and things.
All right, thank you. Sister Judy, go ahead. You're muted if you're talking.
Okay, I'm sorry. I was trying to get unmuted. I'm going to kind of say the same thing, but if you think deeply, there should be no real reason. I mean, we all know slavery happened. It's not that many. It's a lot of facts to release, but if you think deeply, that probably is the reason now suddenly that they are suddenly so opposed to the history being taught, is because they know that they're going to find out that we're going to evict them all off of our land. Okay, that's it.
Yes, okay. Now, just so you all know, you know, since we're on this topic and this is where we sit, I wanna share my screen and show you this. And if you're if you should be muted, please mute yourself because we don't want to hear your comments. But if you went to, I should do like Bill does, and copy this. But here is a copy of the speech that Dr. Ivan Van Sertima did testifying before Congress. And he's quoting Dr. Ivan Van Sertima. He did this July 7th, 1987. And he's quoting Christopher Columbus when he ran into people in Panama, and they were talking about the black people, you know, because they had gotten some gold-tipped spears, and they had gotten them from some black people, and so there's a whole thing that he did. This particular one looks like you have to pay for, and this is something I just searched, you know, immediately as people were talking, but search for Van Sertima before Congress challenging the Columbus myth. And he outlines a whole thing about that. Okay. All right. Where are we? Anyone else would like to step in and make a comment before we continue?
I would just real quick.
And then you go next, Katabas.
One thing I was struck by is the mention of COINTELPRO and all of the, you know, the confusion that was created by them. I think we need to revisit that, you know, that period, because a lot of confusion between black organizations was really was actually provoked through this governmental action. And so, and then a lot of us, and so we have these disagreements where we like, you know, sometimes we're harder on each other than we are on the those who would enslave us.
Yes.
But I think that we need to really examine that period and seek to reconcile with each other with the understanding that there was a covert governmental effort to separate us and the movement and to destroy our movement. And so a lot of the things that happened that we assumed they didn't happen by chance. And so that's what kind of struck me as I was listening, and how they were trying to, you know, distance King from the people, even his wife. And so that, and it wasn't just him, it was a lot of different factions of that movement. So I just, that's what came to me that I wanted to just bring.
Very good. Go ahead, Kat.
Yeah. Couple of things. I think the question of black people being indigenous to this land, I think it does pose somewhat of a dichotomy for us, in much of the respect that Sister Afua outlined. And I'm not sure how we clarify it or develop that concept further. But I think it does pose some questions and somewhat of some conflict for us in that regard. And in regard to what Minister Amani was talking about, a thing that I was thinking about along those lines is the breadth and the depth of this government to keep us disorganized. I mean, that is a lot of work. That is a lot of effort to keep us confused, to keep us disorganized. And it should serve to embolden us to be stronger, to question things more, because the lies in regard to affairs and things has been one of the biggest ones that have been circulating out there. Recently read an article of some black politicians. I think he's might be in the state of North Carolina, who came out and attacked Dr. King on his birthday, talking about all the women that that he was involved with, throwing around numbers and what have you. And in fact, this guy went as far as to attack the whole civil rights movement, you know, saying that it was ridiculous and African Americans need to step away from it. So, you know, they always are able to find these sycophants and push them out there. And they always are spineless and cowardly enough to go out and make these kind of comments, to do the bidding for these white supremacists. And so clearly our task and our work is still very much ahead of us. You know, it's a hard, difficult work, but, you know, I don't think we have any options but to continue to reach out, to push out, to stand for truth and to articulate the truth as we know it.
Okay. God, you guys are so many intelligent people within WOSAI and associated with WOSAI. I'm glad to be among you. That's very true. I want to share another thing before we go on. How many, particularly in the Bay Area, are familiar with Marvin X? Brother Marvin X. He's a poet. And years ago, he wrote this poem. I do sometimes. I open up my message. Well, I used to years ago open up some of my messages with this poem. And by the way, before I go on, you know, I mentioned there's some things that Minister Bill put in the chat. He has Black People Are Indigenous Americas. It's on Amazon. He has the Journal of African Civilizations for Congress. And then he also put, and then I just put Marvin X, Black History is World History. And I also put that the first video, I guess it would be the second video that we put on tonight by the Professor of Truth. So if you're able to get those things out of the chat, these are all useful. Hold tight just a second. So here's Marvin X, and so he wrote this poem. I want to say it was like 1982 he wrote this poem. And so he starts out, "Before the earth was, I was. Before time was, I was. You found me not long ago and called me Lucy. I was 4 million years old." And then he runs down, you know, "I'm the first man. I walked the Nile from Congo to Delta, 4,000 mile jog, but Black history is world history." And then he goes all over the world. "I lived in the land of Canaan before Abraham, before Hebrew was born. I am Canaan, son of Ham. I laugh at Arabs and Jews fighting over my land. I lived in Saba, southern," you know, and he just goes, "Babylon. I left my mark from Babylon to Timbuktu." Then he goes into Europe. He says, "I am the first European, call me Negrito or Grimaldi. I walked the Mediterranean from Spain to Greece. Oh, Greece, why did you kill Socrates? Why did you give him the poison hemlock?" And he goes on. So he's talking about our presence in Europe. And then he goes on, he says, "I am the first Chinese. China has my eyes. I am the Aboriginal Asian. Look for me in Vietnam, Cambodia, Thailand. I am there. Even today, Black and beautiful." And then, as we're talking about now, I used to travel to America long before Columbus came to me asking for directions. Americo Vespucci, on his voyage to America, saw me in the Atlantic returning to Africa. America was my home before Aztec, Maya, Toltec, Inca, and Olmec. I was there. I came to Peru 20,000 years ago. I founded Mexico City. See my mighty pyramids and my Cabeza Colossal in Veracruz and the Yucatan. That's me. I am the Mexican, for I am mixed with all men, and all men are mixed with me. I am the most just of men. And, you know, and he goes on, and then he says, sometimes, he says, sometimes I let tyrants devour me. Sometimes people falsely accuse me. Sometimes people crucify me, but I am ever returning. I am eternal. I am universal. Africa's my home. Asia's my home. America's my home. Black history is world history. And then he has a selected bibliography, J.A. Rogers, W.B. Du Bois, or Du Bois, A Stolen Legacy, Yosef Ben Yekinen, African Origin of Major Western Religions, Message to the Black Man, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad that came before Columbus, African Explorers in the New World, Harold Lawrence, I'm not familiar with that one, Crisis Magazine, June 62, Destruction of Black Civilization, Cultural Unity of Black Africa, and Man, God, and Civilization. So there are a lot of things to that. And so I put that in the chat as well. And so what we're saying, what we're all saying is very valid. And there's some historical presence towards that. Now, getting back to Dr. King, just today, researching him, I didn't realize that Dr. King was the quarterback on his high school football team. You never hear that. And then he entered Morehouse. Guess how old he was when he entered Morehouse? Anybody know?
15.
15, yes. Dr. King was 15 going into college. And I think when he got out of Crosser University. I can't remember, but he was like 22 when he had his master's. Dr. King was just that alone. Dr. King was a very brilliant man. He used to win oratorical contests, you know, before he really got into, the whole pastoring thing of Dexter Avenue Baptist Church. Dr. King, if nothing else, if he did nothing, Dr. King was just a very brilliant brother. You know, those are things that we don't, look at. Of course, I made a PowerPoint. So let me share something. But also,
bring it on.
I want to encourage you to go in the chat and copy those things that are put in the chat, or you can just go to the top three lines of the chat and just say save chat, and you can save the chat and you can go back and get some of the things that people have dropped in. Celeste, were you going to say something?
Two things. The methodology, the coming up with the affairs and the character assassination has been directed toward everyone they thought was a possible leader of Blacks or an organization. And they tried to make us have a leader that they thought would go to the way they wanted things to happen, point one. So if you look at any of the background of any of the leaders we've had, they come up with the same thing. The second comment about us being here first, weren't all the continents connected at one point?
Yes, they were.
Called Pangaea?
Yes, yes.
And if the cradle of civilization is the Nile and all the continents were connected, then Africans would have been everywhere at some point in time. And we would have been first because we are first.
Yes, yes. Oh, there you go. Okay, those are all good points. So let me share this here. Just a second. So I just happen to have a PowerPoint. Who knew? All right. So, Dr. King, yeah, and there, look at him. Handsome guy, looks you straight in the eye. Struggles and victories, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So here's some sources that I use for reading about Dr. King. Now, Van Sertima, you know, in the whole Journal of African Civilizations, Dr. Ivan Van Sertima, he had a series of books. And one of them is Great Black Leaders, Ancient and Modern. This is the first copy that I had. But this, the next time it came out, I like this. I actually like both covers, but this one is good in this respect because it has the people that are talked about in the book. So Malcolm, Queen T, Kwame Nkrumah, Frederick Douglass, Imhotep, Nelson Mandela, Queen Nzinga, Martin Luther King Jr. There's two great articles on Martin Luther King Jr. Toussaint Louverture, Shaka Zulu, Queen Hatshepsut, Ramses II, Marcus Garvey, and Hannibal. So this is a good book to get. I don't know if it's still $20. I bought it a long time ago. And then also back in the 90s, 1991, to be exact, my aunt gave me this book. My aunt from Maryland, Aunt Audrey, we call her Saint Audrey, because not that she's such a Catholic or anything, but she just said Saint Audrey. But anyway, she gave me this book, Bearing the Cross by David Aguero, very good resource to find out about Dr. King. So here they are again. And so, yeah, Great Black Leaders, Ancient and Modern. And the two articles were written by David Levering Lewis on Martin Luther King. And the other one, The Promise, and what Lewis is talking about, the promise of nonviolence and populism, and the essence of King's true greatness. These are two articles that are in Great Black Leaders, Bearing the Cross by David Garrow. And so I already asked this question about, what was his name? And then I was going to read this italicized portion, but in all of Van Sertima's books, he goes through every thing that's covered in his introduction. And he has a really good part about Martin Luther King in here that you can read. I'm not going to go. And then in that first article, they said that there's two ways to kind of look at King, Selma, like before Selma and after, and then the Chicago demonstrations. Now, I think when you study Martin Luther King, you should also include Malcolm X. And this picture is the only time that they met. They met during the deciding of the Civil Rights Bill, and they met in the Capitol. One was coming around one corner, one was coming around the other, and they had a surprise meeting, and of course there were photographers following both of them, and this is one of the pictures that were taken. Look at how, because at that time it was presented that they were fiercely against each other and this and that, and sometimes Malcolm would attack King in his speeches, but look at the joy that they have on their faces, meeting one another. So it's kind of like the two lands of Kemet coming together, upper and lower Kemet coming together. It's a beautiful picture.
A firm grip on the handshake.
Yes. Now, I got this from Kwame Ture, and he said this about these two. He said, King was a mobilizer and Malcolm was an organizer. He said, King was a mobilizer and Malcolm was an organizer. He said, King brought thousands of people into the streets to overturn the law. Just think about that. He was able to organize not only him as individually, but his organization and organizations that were associated. They brought thousands of people in the streets to overturn the law. That is profound. The other thing, as we continue, Malcolm organized more than over 100 mosques all over the country. What a shame that in their life, they weren't able to somehow come together. Organizing thousands of people into the streets to overturn the law and organizing 100 mosques or 100 organizations all over the country. January 15th, 1929 is when Dr. King was born. I thought Dr. King, just trying to remember, was 42 when he was assassinated. Dr. King was only 39 years old when he was assassinated. 1944, he entered Morehouse in Atlanta. That's a shout out to you, Judy. Okay, and then June 1948, King graduates from Morehouse College with a bachelor's degree in sociology. He entered Crozer Theological Seminary, Chester, Pennsylvania, 1948. 1951, he graduates with a bachelor's degree in divinity studies. 51, he entered Boston University. 1953, he marries Coretta Scott King. 'And there's some other things that are associated with him, you know, that had an impact on his life and our lives. So 1954, the Supreme Court rules segregation unconstitutional in the Brown versus Board of Education, Topeka, Kansas. 54, he became pastor of Dexter Avenue Baptist Church, Montgomery, Alabama. 1955, he receives his PhD from Boston University. His first child born, 1955, Yolanda Denise is born. 1955, Coretta Scott King is arrested for disobeying segregationist policies in Montgomery. And this is a very poignant point in our history, because this started a whole lot of things. And then the Montgomery bus boycott begins. And you can go back and find tapes. There used to be a program when I was growing up in the Bay Area. It was called Rush Toward Freedom. And it was narrated by Julian Bond. Used to come on KPIX or Channel 5, and, you know, just outlines all of the things dealing with the Montgomery bus boycott and other boycotts that Dr. King led. 1956, his home was bombed. 1956 Supreme Court rules that bus segregation is unconstitutional. And then in 1957, the SCLC, Southern Christian Leadership Conference, is formed, and they made Dr. King the president. And I'm sure this vexed a lot of people on the other side. He was featured on the cover of Time magazine. I think he was Man of the Year. Second son was born in 57. And he wrote his first book, Strive Towards Freedom, The Montgomery Story. It's published. And then, and this is something that, that can happen sometimes, a mentally ill Black woman stabs King. He was signing books in Harlem. And someone asked him, they said, she goes up and she says, are you Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King? And he, you know, he looked up and he said, yes, yes, I am, ma'am. And then she stabbed him. And it was just inches away from his heart. If it just been any closer, he could have died right then. I'm going to stop here and see if everybody is still awake. And just
I tell you what, as you kept going, I kept saying, I'm still not born yet. I'm still not born yet. I'm still not born yet. Wow. He did so many things long before I was even thought about. Isn't that something?
Yeah. Yeah.
I tell you.
Yeah. Yeah. So yeah. I mean, the man is profound. And then getting back to, and we're going to talk about this, but, you know, J. Edgar Hoover, He was a very evil man in our eyes. You know, I'm sure in somebody else's eyes he was a patriot, but his crimes against Black people go all the way back to Garvey. He started that with Garvey. And just leaders from Garvey to King, you know, Nation of Islam, Malcolm X, the Black Panther Party, the US movement, and other movements around the country. Bill put another thing in the chat. What was that you put in, Bill? What did that you just put in? The last thing. You're muted.
Sir, it's just a link to the paper that you cited from Dr. Van Sertima where he made a statement before Congress about Columbus.
All right. Great. Thanks. Any comments? I just want to pause here. We have less than 30 minutes for this session, unless you want to go over. I don't think Women of Wall Street are meeting tonight, are they? All right. So, any other comments? I just find when you study his life, we're just doing a really 5,000 foot view, 30,000 foot view of Dr. King. There's so many aspects. You can take each little piece that I showed and do at least 30 minutes on it. You know, there's so much to his life. We're gonna say, it looks like you're getting ready to say something, Kat.
I was just curious if anybody know anything else about the woman that stabbed him. Was she, you know, determined to be mentally ill, or was she a possible assassin?
You know, I always hear that. Okay, and you know what? Some of us are mentally deranged. Some of our people, like, okay, you have people that are defending Donald Trump, you know, will want to fight you physically, you know.
But I'm curious if there's been any follow-up on that aspect, on this woman.
Not sure. Anybody know anything? Anybody here know anything?
Okay.
Yeah. That I've always heard that was a mentally deranged woman, but then again,
that's a good question, though.
Yeah.
I mean, what happened to her? She just kind of disappeared, just kind of folded back into society. Was she institutionalized? There should be some kind of track record on this woman.
I think she died in 1950.
Go ahead.
She died in 1958. I'm sorry, she stabbed him in 1958. She died when she was 98.
So she lived a long life.
Yes. Wow. I can't see the rest of the article because I don't have whatever this is, but let's see if there's another one.
Was she ever institutionalized?
I got to find a whole article. The New York Times. Oh, nope, that's the same one. They won't let me see it till I own it.
Oh, yeah, I hate those.
Yeah.
Let's see who else had something to say.
I mean, she's kind of an infamous person, you know, in a dastardly kind of way. But he'd be interested in knowing more about her. Did she, you know, did she have a family? You know, what was her story?
Good question.
I found something on Wikipedia. It says 5 days after the stabbing, it looks like she was committed to a hospital for the criminally insane.
Ooh. Yeah, okay. Well, she was institutionalized.
And then after 14 years, she was transferred to the Manhattan Psychiatric Center. And then to a residential care program in Rosedale, Queens, where after a fall, she was placed in a New York nursing home where she resided until death.
Yeah, it sounds like she was insane.
Did he give her name? The earlier part of it, her last name was Curry.
Izola, I-Z-O-L-A, Izola Curry.
And there's another article from King's Institute at Stanford that says she was born in Adrian, Georgia, and she moved to New York at the age of 20. Shortly after her relocation, she developed paranoid delusions about the NAACP, Martin Luther King, and other civil rights leaders. After stabbing King, she was arrested at the scene and found to be carrying a loaded gun. When questioned by police, she accused civil rights leaders of boycotting and torturing her, as well as causing her to lose jobs and forcing her to change her religion. Curry also suggested that dangerous connections were being forged between the civil rights movement and the Communist Party. After authorities informed her.
Can I stop you right there? That is the same story that J. Edgar Hoover had, that the civil rights movement, the black liberation movements in this country were being funded and supported by communist Russia. That was J. Edgar, paid to be insane. That's right.
But that was the trigger point, right? Uh-huh. You know, if you want to get everybody all upset, tell them they're communist.
Yeah. It was a very toxic word, still is.
Yes.
Yeah. That's all very interesting. I have some pretty strange thoughts floating through my head right now in terms of, could this woman have been programmed some kind of way?
Well, it says that she was placed in Bellevue for observation and was found not competent to stand trial. And she was diagnosed as a paranoid schizophrenic, which committed her to that state hospital.
Right. And that's a good place to hide people away, too.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So, you know, you never hear from them again.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's all good information. Thanks for.
And let me thank you. Thank you for raising that. You know, I never really thought of that, Kat. I'm glad you did. And I'm glad you all did that research on it. I couldn't tell who was talking. Was that Akanke that was reading that? Who was that?
That was Sister Celeste, I believe.
Celeste.
Yeah.
Thank you, Celeste, for following up on that. But I wanted to share this with you all. How many are aware of this? This here. This is the code name that the FBI had for Martin Luther King.
I don't think I've seen that one before.
And there's a book. There's this book, Codename Zorro, The Murder of Martin Luther King Jr. by Mark Lane and Dick Gregory. This is the name that they had for Martin Luther King.
Yeah. And it's been reported that it's been at least 4 or 5 different law enforcement agency that was in town that night. CIA, the FBI, the local metropolitan police, and the local state police all were in town at the time of Dr. King's murder. So it seems to me to be pretty clear it was government inspired, and these people are treacherous. I mean, there's nothing too low for them to do. But
they had to do it carefully when they plotted all this out. They had to not look like they were guilty, and they had to make sure that the person that was killed would not become a martyr.
And yes. They had to make sure that
so
you
then
had
the
a
stories
fall
came. Zorro in Spanish means fox.
Mm-hmm. Is that right? I didn't know. I thought it was from a movie.
Mm-hmm. And they always give you a fall guy, which is exactly what happened with Lee Harvey Oswald.
Saraswati put this picture in. This is her, the woman who stabbed him.
Yeah.
He doesn't look very sick to me.
Yeah, she doesn't. Yeah.
Looks fairly normalized here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Something triggered her.
Yeah.
Who stabbed who? I missed that part. I'm sorry.
She probably was programmed by MK Ultra.
There you go. All of these things, are possible. Judy, we were talking about the person who stabbed Martin Luther King in 1958 as he was at a book signing in Harlem.
Okay.
I got a chance to go to the Lorraine Hotel and visit that whole thing. Mm. They were talking about, and I also had a chance. I was working with a nonprofit, and we were freedom riders, and I had a chance to take some students, black and white, and we went as though they were doing a freedom rider. You know, they were going to do another march in Memphis, the Hunger March, the second one, you know, in honor of Dr. Martin Luther King. I went there then, but they were talking, and they had a mock trial also that they talked about what happened that day. And of course, Lorraine Motel, he usually had a room in the back of the motel as opposed to front. That particular day, they moved his room to the front of that motel for some reason. And I got a lot of notes and I got a lot of pictures, but it was a lot of interesting things and a lot of people when we went through that mock trial that were part of that day that it happened, actually. And then they were talking about that there was a person in the bushes, actually, that did the firing of the gun as opposed to, what's his name, Lee, whatever.
Lee Harvey Oswald.
Yes, as opposed to him. They
always give you a phone.
No, was it Lee Harvey Oswald? Was that his name? Is that the
No, Ray. That was with that's King. The guy that did that's Kennedy. The
guy. Yeah,
James
that's the
Ray.
Guy. James Earl Ray.
James Earl Ray's brother was at this mock trial, and they were talking about that whole thing on how he didn't really do that, but it was very interesting.
But that's the way they work. See, that's the way they work. These governments, they do these dastardly things, and then they make sure that there's a fall person, you know, so you stop looking. Hey, you know, we got the guy. So there's no need to look any further. Or, compromise somebody and you get them institutionalized, they never heard of again. You know, that's the way they work and operate.
She was institutionalized within a month of the stabbing.
Mm-hmm.
A month of the day, actually.
So Sister Judy had her hand up, so I'm going to, if you could hold your comments, everyone, go ahead, Judy, say what you were going to say, and then we'll look at what Bill just put in the chat. Go ahead. Judy?
Okay, yes, I'm sorry. I was saying I lost you all for about 20 minutes, but I was going to say Also, I shouldn't say able, but I attended a play in Atlanta. I think it might have been on Broadway or maybe off Broadway. It was a play where they tried, I was so disgusted. I don't remember the name of it, but where they had this one room at play where they're all, the setting is inside the Lorraine Motel, and they're basically trying to say what happened that very night before he was shot, and they have him, one of the housekeepers in the hotel motel is in there, and they're kind of trying to show he's a womanizer, and he gets on the phone during the play and calls Coretta and pretends like he's just, you know, relaxing and about to go to sleep, and this maid is in there, and they never really have any intimacy, but you know, they are just trying to really mess up his reputation, which I know there were things that were said, but that play came out, and I'm glad it didn't really, I think it was on off Broadway for a minute. I don't know if anybody's familiar with that particular play.
You know, it's a shame that you didn't start with us, because we played a tape by a brother who calls himself the Professor of Truth that spoke about that and said that those were all lies, and they've never produced those tapes, never been able to prove those things about Dr. King. With respect to Isola Curry, Saraswati gave us the name and the picture. Brother Bill put in the chat, a psychiatrist diagnosed Curry as a paranoid schizophrenic, reporting that Curry had an IQ of 70 and was in a severe state of insanity. On October 20th, she was found incapable of understanding the charge against her. And then he puts, really? And then people with 70 IQ who can't understand a criminal charge commonly carry a knife and an Italian pistol in their bra.
Yeah, she looks so normal in that picture.
She does. She looks like my aunt. I'm sorry. She's like my aunt in Texas. I mean,
she's well-dressed with her beads and everything. And
What makes you think people that are insane look different than the rest of us?
That's a good point. Yes, some insane people look quite normal. Sure.
And also, isn't it possible that they programmed her some kind of way to do it? You know,
I had already offered that theory, Judy.
I
could have used drugs.
Some kind of mind control or anything to take over her to have her do it. I mean, I think the Navy was doing all kind of experiments on people, so I don't know. It's possible, maybe.
CIA was doing a lot of experimentation around that time on mind control, using a lot of different drugs from LSD to other things. So they were definitely involved, and their focus was on the mind to be able to control human behavior.
Well, let me just say this, and this is what I've always heard, is that there are one of the largest concentrations of PhDs are in the CIA.
Okay. I wouldn't doubt it.
Yeah, those
did
people.
Did they earn those, or were they assigned to them?
Well, whether they earned them or not, I think that's a very interesting phenomenon. We have about 5 minutes left in this segment. Okay, can you hold your point? Tomorrow we're going to have a study of sacred scriptures. If you'd like to join us, it's a repeat, but it bears repeating. It's going to be on Amen. So if you'd like to join us tomorrow at 6 o'clock on this Zoom channel.
PST time.
Yeah. Okay. You know what? Someone just put in the chat that PhD is a base requirement for DARPA. Okay. So they have some very intelligent people in that organization in various fields. So that's really the point. I'm sorry. Mama Fua, go ahead. Mama Fua, then Sister Judy, go ahead.
Thank you. Mine's going to be just very brief because I had a question and I wanted to ask so many times before, but the conversation was deep. But I wanted to talk about or hear some more information about MLK's spiritual side and how that motivated him, where it came from, and, you know, how much of it was in all of his speeches, you know, and the family life. We didn't talk about his family life either. So maybe some future discussion, we can handle that.
Yes. Well, he was raised in a in an upper Black middle class family. His father was a minister. We didn't get to the part where he went to India and observed and studied nonviolence. And nonviolence in India is one of the eight limbs of yoga. It's called ahimsa. And so Gandhi was really just using that concept in yoga. It's called ahimsa. It means nonviolence. He was a very spiritual man, not only just satisfied to be a Black preacher. And, you know, he could have just had a very comfortable life. But he wanted to liberate and bring African people, you know, like we say at WOSA, returning our people to our traditional greatness. That was what he was about. He was not only a religious man, but he was a very spiritual man. Mm-hmm. Yes. Sister Judy, you had your hand up. We have about 2 minutes.
Yes, the only thing I wanted to add, you all may have already mentioned this. A lot of times when I mentioned, we have conversations about MLK, people don't know that his mother was also assassinated in the church during a church service right there in Atlanta at the old Ebenezer sanctuary where Daddy King preached. So a shooter came in during service and shot the mother down.
Get out of my head. That was the last thing that I was going to say. But that is... But what that is
the date on that?
It was like maybe about 2 or 3 years later after he had been killed.
I think it was later than that, wasn't it? I don't think it was just 2 or 3.
Well, so he was assassinated in 1968, and I think this happened like in either 72 or 73.
Oh yeah, maybe that's true.
Don't quote me on that, but it was and you know what? People just okay, that happened, and then people went on to the next thing. You know, and isn't that odd? Yeah, his mother was assassinated in the church.
Assassinations were so much a part of the fabric at that time. People were being assassinated and dropping left and right, starting with John F. Kennedy. And again, there was a lot of different factors involved in that, and different shooters and that type of thing, then right on to Dr. King and then
Malcolm X.
Robert and then later Malcolm. And so that decade or that sliver of time of about 10 years, man, assassinations were quite prominent, sadly, in society.
But you would think that you would hear the assassination of Martin Luther King and his mother, that they don't, you know, that's two assassinations. They just I've gone to the King Center here in Atlanta through they have a huge center and interactive, two different buildings of all kind of stuff. They may mention it. I won't say that. Somewhere in there, maybe it's mentioned in one of the interactive pieces of media. But the other thing I was going to add is also some years later, his brother mysteriously drowned in the swimming pool.
Mm-hmm. Well, the mother was killed on June
30th,
1974.
1974.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right. You were close, Minister. You were close.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah. And the brother, what was the brother's name? Did you all know he drowned in a pool? It was very mysterious too.
ADT.
You know, what this says is this subject is so full information, and we really could go on into the next day talking about this, but I'd like to conclude with a birthday wish, Dr. King, and see you all next time. Thank you for coming.
We can't do a part two. We can't do a part two.
Well, I heard Mama Fua say, can we do a part two? What do you guys think? Should we continue this next week?
Yeah.
Okay. Next week, we'll continue. Thank you, Ali. We'll continue on this subject. Well, we'll pick up where we left off. Thank you, Minister Makalisi, for your comment in the chat. Thank you, Bill. Always put great comments. And thank you all for sharing. Such a great and dynamic group, WOSA community, all across the country. We give thanks for your participation. All right. Guidance and protection, life, prosperity, and health. Hopefully, we'll see you tomorrow. We're going to be studying Amen at Study of Sacred Scriptures. All right. Guidance and protection.
Great class. Great session.
Okay. Yes.
Live up.
Outstanding minister.
Very all good. Right. Learned a lot.
Thank you for coming, Barbara.
Thank you for coming, Barbara Smith Jowles. She's a guest.
You know what? Hey, Barbara. Yeah, Barbara's been by, been here before. Thank you for coming, Barbara. Yes.
She's
thanks.
Family now.
All right.
Excellent.
Good job, Sinead.
Oh, good job, Sinead.